gives us an opportunity not to rush through it, but really take the time to unpack it and really discuss the need as we try to continue to compete in Hillsborough County and create, you know, a premier school district, not only throughout the state, but throughout this nation. Before we do this, we've got to really talk about where we were for the last 2 years. And because our role and responsibility is to make sure that we've been transparent and also to create trust with our community about how we're leveraging and being solid stewards of taxpayer dollars. In the last 2 years, each of you know that we come in and we identified $150 million in a deficit. But I want to be able to share all the proactive steps that we've taken to make certain that we are becoming back in line financially and putting Hillsborough County back in a fiscal responsible stance and being able to put us in a good solid place related to our finances. In this, we've taken had to make some very difficult, hard choices over the last 2 years, from reducing positions at the school and district level, being able to look at how we leverage federal dollars and release general fund dollars, how are we being more efficient with our transportation due to rerouting and being in a better job with making certain that we're being efficient with yellow fleet and white fleet, how we renegotiated contracts in our district to selectively abandon contracts that did not align with our strategic plan, or they do have not aligned with and shown organizational impact, and also revamping systems within this work. To date, we know that we have had to address our staffing model. Coming in, we were, we looked at the number of staffs compared to the Big Five school districts. And the one we say we're most we compared to was Broward County. Broward County has 30,000 more students than Hillsborough County. But in 2019-2020 analytics, while we had 25,000 plus employees, Broward County has 30,000 more students, and we had the same number of employees as they did. So we had to come in and look at our allocation model, both at the district level and also at the school level. And as you can see through this chart, it just shows the proactive steps that we have taken in order to be able to get in greater compliance in serving our students and serving the district level with positions that are not duplicated or positions that are not showing and demonstrating that positive organizational impact. Over the last 2 years, we've instilled a hiring freeze consistently and making certain that we have organizational controls that go through the human resources with our CFO, our chiefs within our divisions, our chief of staffs, and myself, all reviewing every position to make certain that it's needed and make sure it's serving students in a proper manner to be able to improve student performance and outcomes. We have phased out and removed over 1,000 instructional and non-instructional positions within Hillsborough County, and I've also had to move 400 teachers from one location to another school based on staff enrollment to make certain that we're in compliance with the staff allocation model, and then also eliminating positions that are not just really mission critical with our work. So we've done a really good job over the last 2 years, really, for lack of a better word, tightening our belt and really proven to our community in a transparent manner of the proactive steps that we have taken to be in a better positive light financially. This will be the first year in a decade that Hillsborough County closes a school year not in a financial deficit. And, you know, that is through hard work, tough choices, and we'll continue to make certain we move in the right direction to prove confidence in overall with fiscal responsibility. But it's important for us to understand when we're asking the community to once again to, you know, double down and to engage with us financially and help us fund and fill the gaps that we are currently seeing financially from the state is to know the financial landscape. And Hillsborough County ranks 45th out of 67 counties in the state of Florida connected to local per pupil funding. And when you're the seventh largest district serving 220,000 students, this is a major problem. So we've got to find proactive solutions and different solutions to be able to fill the voids to give our children and our schools a chance to be able to compete. Also, we know that inflation has, over the last 15 years, seen a skyrocket mentality. However, we can recognize that educational funding has not kept up with inflation, and we'll show that in a little bit related to where inflation has transitioned nationally and where we are currently funded at from a state level. And then overall, looking at the state of Florida, we're ranked 45th in the nation with total per pupil funding. And we see, because of the 45th ranking throughout the nation, that we see other school districts trying to find additional revenues and revenue streams just to stay afloat and meet the growing demands of our community and our students. When we talk about inflation for the United States, we see we used this model in 2007 and took it all the way for the last 15 years. And the reason we used 2007, because that was the highest per pupil funding that we have recognized in the state for many, many years. And if we see from 2007 to 2022, we've realized a 32.8% increase in inflation. But if we go and look at what we've received from the Department of Education in that same time span, while we've realized a 32% increase in inflation, we've only seen a 7.93% increase in educational funding. And, you know, that creates a major gap that school districts are having to fill around the state in order to create the best experiences for our students inside and outside of our classrooms and also in common areas. And we see the inflation rate from Florida last year alone in 2021 was at 6.8%, close to 7%, which continues to put financial stressors not only on our community, but also on us as tech, you know, within our school district, because we are realizing having to pay more for fuel with our buses and all our white fleet, more for lumber, more for concrete supplies, for infrastructure. All that's being recognized within our school district. This is a slide that we compare ourselves to the top five school districts in the state. And column two identifies our state formula as we engage in the Florida Educational Finance Plan. In order to do that, you have to levy a certain percentage within the school district, which we do. So we take column two, which we generate from the state, and we look at our unweighted FTE, which is our enrollment, and we divide the second column to the third column, and it gives us our FEFP per pupil funding. And compared to the other big five school districts, inclusive of Pinellas, we are the lowest per pupil funding in the big five in the state. Go to the next column with our total revenue. This is inclusive of any property tax, millage, PICO, capital outlay funding, impact fees, any additional referendums, and gives you our total revenue, and divide that by our unweighted FTE. And once again, Hillsborough County is identified as the lowest per pupil funding, creating strains on us financially. But we look at the first reason to be able to go out for this millage. And the first is to properly compensate every one of our employees in our school district. And that's from instructional staff to non-instructional staff within the organization, and show a sense of care and a sense of value. And I use the example of the national crisis that we're exposed to right now is the Great Resignation. Currently, there's 4,000 instructional vacancies in the state of Florida, meaning 84,000 students aren't being served by a highly qualified skilled teacher. And we look at, they are projected through the Great Resignation article that at the end of the school year, that we will realize 9,000 instructional vacancies throughout the state. If you look at the average in Hillsborough County, we have doubled what we currently have. We have 400 instructional vacancies, meaning 8,000 students do not have stability within our classrooms. We're doing everything we can to take certified personnel from the district to push them into these classrooms. But we also recognize non-instructional positions having close to 600 vacancies within our school district, which openly is unacceptable. Our team is doing a really good job with our recruiting efforts. However, we see that it's not only unique through Hillsborough County, but throughout the state and throughout this nation. And we see that we also recognize that an increase in student enrollment, which means that our demands will be greater to add additional teachers and support staff in an effort to be successful. And we see, because of the shortage, is that local employees are paying at a higher wage, meaning that highly qualified skilled teachers and leaders have greater accessibility to go outside of our school district because they have greater compensation packages within our schools. And for us, we must do something. We have got to be able to focus on proactive strategies to keep our best and brightest in front of our students. And this next slide talks about the historical trends since 2017 of where we are with instructional vacancies, seeing a 240% increase, which is continued to be greater concern. And how do we compare to other school districts? We know that Duval County and Orange County have close to 700 instructional vacancies, which once again, it continues to be a state effort. If we look at our teaching experience, only 24% of Hillsborough County highly effective teachers have more than 20 years of experience or in front of our children, meaning that our seasoned, qualified teachers that understand pedagogy, understand how to be a life coach, understand content, understand connectivity and gaining access to students, that they're leaving the profession, especially within the Tampa region. So this is something that we have to be able to address to be able to recruit the best and the brightest to our school district. The second reason for us to go out and ask for millions is to be able to expand enrichment opportunities. Every one of our students deserve to have the opportunity to be exposed to vibrant, thriving art, music, and physical education classrooms. This is not the case in Hillsborough County, where 15,000 students are not served with art and music, and meaning that they don't get a chance to fall in love with classes such as Mrs. Chick at Roosevelt. And they don't get a chance to be able to let their hair down and have and display their passions for visual and performing arts. And we know that students who are involved in visual performing arts, they compete better academically, socially, emotionally than others who do not. And we just want to make sure we can have that continuum of courses from elementary, middle school, and high school, just allow our children to compete. And we see that there's major burden on our parents and our teachers to raise money for new instruments, to raise money for supplies, to raise money for field experiences. And we want to be able to fill that void so no additional funding is needed for them to be able to raise for these initiatives and full programs. Then also the lastly is that we see, and these are pictures of our classrooms that have obsolete and broken instruments. While we may have, really cool state-of-the-art instruments in some of our schools, and I give Roosevelt because they have a great support structure, not every one of our schools in this district has that same support structure. So being able to address equity across our district is a must, in giving our children the equipment, the materials, the resources, and the teachers they need in order to thrive and excel and fall in love with the performing and visual arts. And the third reason is completely linked to workforce development. We have got to make certain we grow a longer, stronger bench and provide opportunities through curriculum advisory boards. And as we're doing today, having job opportunities that children and students can find pathways for them to lead them to be able to be successful. I'm gonna play this video, it's about 2.5 minutes.
Jobs looking for people, then people looking for jobs. Additionally, nearly 72% of Florida's workforce leaders recently surveyed for the Florida Chamber Foundation's Florida Workforce Needs Study 2.0 research have struggled to find qualified talent to fill open positions over the past year.
If we know that economic diversification is a necessary condition for becoming the 10th largest economy by 2030, we know we need to hone in on our workforce and diversify the talent pipeline. Why it is the way it is because of how open Florida is. It's open for business, we're free, and we're rocking on all cylinders thanks to the governor. And so we're both burdened and blessed with a thriving economy, but yet on the other hand, that presents challenges by way of having the necessary talent.
So today's employers have to be both proactive and reactive to our changing labor supply, anticipating what today's employees are looking for and being responsive to the dynamic changes in our labor force and in our economy.
And the Florida Chamber Foundation for decades has been leading the fight and leading the research to figure out how can Florida win the talent war, and how can Florida have the number one workforce in the United States.
In addition to solving the current talent crisis, Florida needs to think ahead. The FloridaScorecard.org tells us that Florida will need to create nearly 1.62 million net new jobs by 2030 to not only keep up with current workforce demand, but to prepare for the almost 3.5 million more residents that will call Florida home.
These avenues are open, they're available, and they're exciting. And no longer is career and technical education something that should be thought of as lesser than. It's not just shop class anymore. We're talking things like artificial intelligence and mechatronics and engineering technology, healthcare, IT, robotics, you name it.
Today's talent pipeline, in fact, going all the way back to our kindergartners. We need to get kindergartners ready for kindergarten. We need third graders reading at third grade level. We need eighth graders on par with math and science and reading. And what we need to be doing is we need to literally join forces with the business community, with talent providers, And we need to make sure that we're preparing the next generation for the skills, the talent, the jobs that we're creating right here in Florida today.
Educator, my role and responsibility is to create and create full option graduates, meaning preparing students to go to post-secondary education, preparing them to go to the military, and also the workforce. So in that process, we have to have vibrant, thriving workforce opportunities for our students to be able to be successful. And we work with the Florida Department of Economic Opportunities and identify two particular areas that we deem to be most important currently, not only in the Tampa region, but throughout the state of Florida, which is medical and construction. And in this process, you'll see that these are jobs that students can transition through immediate credentials with our high schools. And we are working to make certain that we build the capacity through advisory boards, being able to identify and select curriculum that will lead us to be successful for our students. And as you know, 2 months ago, we launched an initiative where we are transforming DW Waters, Bowers Whitley, and also our program at Brewster to create medical pathways and academies for 9 through 12 and technical colleges with partnership with the HCC. And then at the same token, being able to create a building construction academy, all through systemic partnerships with our local, over 100 local companies that have been at the table to help us identify curriculum, help us identify pathways, help us identify equipment and materials to prepare our students for CTE examinations to allow them to transition to successful jobs. So my ask to the board, and they approved on April 19th, was to seek an increase, $1 million increase in an ad valorem tax on August 23rd in the primary, which would generate around $146 million annually for a four-year stint. The option was to either take it for a two-year or a four-year, and I wanted to transition to a four-year because that creates stability, especially with our pay structure, also with stability with expanding workforce and our visual performing arts. And it allows us in the first 3 years to prove competence the same way the Half Cent Penny Executive and Steering Committee has done to be able to improve transparency and organizational impact in a positive manner. So we'll use this funding all for incentivizing our staff to be able to keep them from, you know, being able to address enrichment and also workforce development. So the biggest question we get is in this process, how much is it going to cost the homeowner? And we look at home appraised values from $100,000 to $350,000 because the average within Hillsborough County is around $250,000. So if we look at the $250,000, that would cost an annual $225 annually, which is 67 cents a day for that particular property owner. So all of this to say it's less than a cup of coffee. And we know that $225 may be a lot to some, but when you're talking about instilling and providing and engaging finances into public education, this is where we grow stronger as a community from an economical standpoint, a safety standpoint, and preparing students and children for jobs that do not exist and building the skills they need to be successful. In this $146 million, that we will receive this funding, 16% is statutory required to go to charter schools. And Hillsborough County will receive 84%, which is around, I think, Connor, $116 million. Of the $116 million, my ask and my recommendation to the school board was to use 75% to 80% of that funding, of these funds, to go directly to positively impact all of our employees in a financial model, meaning that the average percent of payroll increase that every one of our employees will recognize will be around 6.5%. And for instructional staff members, that could be an average of 4,000. And for non-instructional, that average would be close to 2,000. It could be greater, depending on what percentage that we levy and we collect at that particular time. And this is assuming a 96%. And we talk about, you know, all of the employees in our district will be impacted. We see here from classroom teachers to bus drivers, food nutrition, after-school enrichment programs, and instructional and non-instructional and intervention social workers and psychologists, school counselors. Everyone would benefit from this particular ask to our community. Also, the funds, $11 million, will be pioneered annually to go to expand visual performing arts. So the 15,000 students who do not have art music and our young learners will allow us to add 45 art teachers, 67 music teachers, 37 PE teachers. And the remaining 5% that we would put would be about just expanding supplies, equipment for enrichment opportunities, and also being able to address any visual audio equipment within our courses that allow our children with the instruments to be able to have the necessary tools and skills to be able to compete within their classrooms. And then openly, workforce development is to have innovative, hire innovative instructors to ignite students' participation, continue to survey our community leads, and also with our partners, with our higher ed, and in our corporations to identify what pathways need to be expanded and really work to redefine and create state-of-the-art equipment in facilities that are most attractive to our students. And we can mirror the current workplace that they will transition to after high school. And then also having greater preparation through stronger content, allowing our students to be successful on their entry certification examinations in that process. So this is a slide that really talks about historical local effort and looking at what we have levied from a local effort from a millage. And we used 2009 because it was around 5.4%. And the highest was in 2012-2013 at 5.6. And it's been steadily declining, and the state identifies what we are expected to levy. We are currently at 3.6. If the increased mill is passed, would be at 4.6. which is significantly lower than what we paid back in the rate in 2010. If the rate would have stayed consistent in 12 and 13, which it did not, we would love that, Hillsborough County would have been able to receive close to $1 billion. And looking at that type of funding of what we're able to revolutionize our industry, what we do to be able to properly compensate our staff and be able to provide innovative pathways and choice opportunities with our schools, it would have been awesome. But the realities are, this hasn't been a reality. So we've got to be able to find additional revenue streams to be able to fill the current voids that we currently have within our school district. Not only are we, asking to generate funding, but this is a slide that really talks about the funding that's generated from the 1 mil increase from the Big Five school districts. And we see that $232 million from Miami-Dade and Orange County is at $149 million. All was really focused on retaining and recruiting highly qualified skilled talent within their school district. And Hillsborough County doesn't have the opportunity to compete. And we talk about equity, not only with our school district, but equity throughout the state. We see that 21 school districts currently have successfully implemented a millage increase, and that we currently have a number of school districts that are going out in 2022. And if you look at our geographical region, you see that Sarasota, Manatee, Pinellas, and Pasco is going out as well currently in the 22 school year. And then Polk will be going out the following year. And everyone is leveraging this to be able to focus on the talent war, to be able to keep our highly qualified skilled teachers that are richly diverse within Hillsborough County to allow us to become a top tier school district. And without additional funding, it'd be very difficult to compete openly and honestly in being able to try to keep not only our teachers, support staff, but also our administrators who can go across the border and make $20,000 more as the AP or $30,000 more as a principal, which is, openly doesn't allow us a chance to be able to have competitive pay schedules and keep them here locally. They stay here because they love Hillsborough, and Hillsborough is a great place to live and to learn. It's a great place to get an education, but we got to show value in that process. And we get a lot of questions about the half cent. Why can't we use the half cent to be, within this process? And we can't use the half cent to offset, current operating expenses. The half cent is completely designed for infrastructure. And I would say that the half cent has done a really good job of creating trust and transparency through the oversight committee. And Ms. Castor has been a major part of that with the Sheriff Cronister, with Ed, at the same token, our current leaders and Mayor Lott. They have done a remarkable job prioritizing funding and making certain that promises made are promises kept. And they're a big reason why that we can lean on them to show that the money that is being generated from this community is openly having a positive impact to create the most attractive facilities that allow our children to psychologically, intellectually, and socially and emotionally compete every single day. And we're thankful for that process. And then important dates. Important dates are July 25th. You know, we cannot as a school district tell individuals how to vote, yes or no, but what we can do is arm them with information and then leverage in important dates for July 25th being a voter registration deadline, going to August 8th, the 21st as a early voting process, and then on the 23rd will be the date for the election. The biggest reason we didn't go for November on the general is because the county has transportation tax coming on, and we wanted the community to be able to focus on two separate issues and really understand these issues individually versus being able to go at the same time. There's pros and cons to doing it at the same time as well, but we think that we can use the next couple of months to be able to actively engage our community and inform them of the current factual information and why we have a growing need to be able to, you know, to leverage this funding to really be able to fill the major vacancies that we have and to be able to keep the talent within our school district. There's a QR code that you can scan. It's on the worksheet and the handout that that Kim sent out to everyone. But what I'm asking this advocacy group to do is to continue to be champions of change, continue to be champions of Hillsborough County. And we know that we may say that this is not the right time, but when you live my side and we look at 8,000 students do not have stability with a quality certified educator in front of them every single day, then we have to do something differently.